Good time of day to all of you, my friends, here on chess.com. This is Grandmaster Alex Chermolinsky. Today I'm in charge of recording a video on the ongoing Prague Masters tournament. Well, the hero of the start, as you can see from the current cross table, is Indian Grandmaster Santosh Vidit, who's leading the field now by a full point. 4 out of 5, great score, and he was unstoppable with white pieces, winning every game so far. Of course, it's still too early to tell how the tournament is going to end, because Vidit is facing two tough games against his immediate competitors, chasing him while being just a point behind Nikita Vityugov and young Krzysztof Duda. But nonetheless, a bulk of work has already been done, and let's see how Vidit accomplished that. The first game was the opening game, round one, where he faced Sam Shankland. Alright, attention to the board. This very quiet line in the Nimza is getting a lot of attention these days, but which is isn't used to be the case because of the modest nature of the move bishop d2. Chess players of today, they keep on searching everywhere for playable lines, trying to put pressure on the opponent and surprise the opponent. And the answer was b6, which is standard, of course. And this line, where a black combines d5 with b6 in the Nimza, it's quite well known. I played it myself more than once. Usually white does not put the bishop on d2 against it. They just play a3, because black most of the time would like to keep the bishop, so they will retreat. But Vidit actually had a new idea. After rook c1, rook e8, which is a perfect looking move, possibly preparing the deep retreat to f8 for the bishop, also planning to play knight e4, an appropriate moment. The Indian Grandmaster played a new move, knight b5, which I find myself very interesting. Obviously, the attack is coming against the pawn on c7, and also white offers that bishop trade, which is desirable, because otherwise the dark square bishop, white's dark square bishop, doesn't have much prospects. So what happens if black takes? Of course it's possible, and they can play c6 if they want to. The knight will return. There is a little bit more later about the move c7, c6, and the implications of that. Well, in this position, I would expect black to continue with knight e4, which of course is a logical move, but white doesn't have to take. They can move the queen somewhere. And, one thing there that we noticed, that black is unable yet to support that knight with the other knight coming to f6, so they need to play it differently. Maybe they want to capture on c3. And I really cannot tell, but clearly white was in white in this position. Shankland replied with a considerably sharper move, an interesting move, knight c6. Now, the situation is such that this capture gives black an important tempo on the white bishop, where knight takes c7 is going to be impossible due to pin on the c-file. You can see, of course, how it works out. You can't really take that rook, because after rook takes c1, you end up losing your bishop, and more importantly, losing your queen to the fork. So Vidit quietly answered with castles, and now white has a threat of rook takes c6, which, let me make a... it's visible. So rook takes c6, which will be material. For example, if you play a nothing move, h6, then rook takes, bishop, and now white continues if he wants to with this one, and Clearly white is at least a pawn ahead and possibly more. So, the bishop retreated to f8. All looking good. Fine. And the white knight was pushed back. And the black bishop returned. So, question is, what did white accomplish? Well, the knight on c6 is possibly not ideally positioned. It blocks the b7 bishop and makes the d5 pawn little vulnerable. After b4, Shankman clearly wanted to do something with this knight, and he played knight back to b8. Logical thinking, in a sense that white also spent some time going with his knight back and forth, so it's okay, but to me it's also interesting what would have happened in case of knight e7. Let's just suppose that white continues in the same fashion. Now, can black now play knight e4? I believe he can, although the variations are not that simple. Critical line. Now knight g5. Hitting that pawn on f7 and also the pawn on e4. Black cannot take the bishop, because then they will lose because of the double threat. Queen takes h7 mate and knight f7 fork. So looks like black is in trouble, but I think bishop d5 would be just fine. After bishop c4, black can play c6, of course, trying to keep things together. But the alternative is to capture and play knight d5. Once again, due to tactics, queen takes d5 is impossible, of course, bishop h2. Black now attacks the white knight and keeps the e4 pawn defended. Should white then go on with knight takes f7, black needs to take on h2, otherwise queen takes d5 comes with check. So he does. And then he takes. Now in itself, this position should be quite okay for black, because the knight on d5 is clearly superior to the white bishop. One concern is black in time to hold his blockade? Should white continue with f3? I believe he can hold things together, thanks to that check, forcing the white king back, and now rook d8 comes just in time. d5 is held, and so is e4. Now I cannot tell that I'm very comfortable playing this position with white, because, well, there could be long-term problems with the weak pawn on e3 and the passive bishop on d2. Of course, this line is by no means forced. White doesn't have to even start with queen b3, and they don't have to take on e4 later on. But if that's the case, then black gets to come with the knight to g6, which may not look very active on that square, but it would give black good control over the e5 square, preventing white of ever placing the knight to that superior position. Let's see what happened after knight b8. Queen there, queen b1. Now, yeah, you may be surprised a little bit at yet another bishop retreat, but black really cannot stop white's main plan with e3, e4. So even the more obvious move knight d7 would still give white possibility of continuing with e4 at the moment they find appropriate. Also, black is not ready yet to counterattack with c5 because of the bishop on b7. White x-rays with the queen. So bishop c8 was an attempt to improve the bishop, but black is probably taking too many liberties here. Vidit immediately struck in the center. This was all forced. Now rook a7, so black is trying to use the 7th rank to bring the rook closer. And he manages to keep the c6 pawn protected for now. Because multiple captures on c6, they don't really give white anything on account of Bishop takes h2. Followed by queen d6 check, and black's perfectly fine, of course. So, but we did play the quiet move h3. His idea is not to hurry with capture of the of that pawn on c6, but he's looking to build up, and it's surprisingly effective kingside attack. Starting with this. Now, the annoying threat is knight c4, because the black rook on e8 is under-defended and always subject to bishop h7 check. So, logical reply. And then, surprising rook lift. In some comments that were published on the internet, I saw a suggestion of queen h5. I think white had a pretty resolute way of dealing with that, with this surprising bishop sacrifice. Well, the thing is that the black queen is trapped. You don't really have the h4 square because of the fork. So, if you're forced to give up your queen, then white should be winning. But I wouldn't say that queen f6 worked out any better for Sam Schenck when the damage already had been done to his position. After this move, he realized that queen e6 would lose the queen anyhow. Check and you must give up the queen. So in desperation, Schenck won't give up the queen, but really he didn't have many hopes, realistic hopes of saving this position. Very energetic play from Vidiot, obviously. If you capture the rook, then comes queen f6 check, winning the black rook. And after knight d7, rook c3, there was nothing for Sam to do but resign the game. Well, an opening disaster, well, if you wish, indeed. Well, the impact on the tournament. Of course, it's a great win for Vidiot. In round-robin tournaments, it's very important to start off with a victory. It gives you confidence and makes your opponent play catch-up. For Schenkwand, it makes it harder, and in the next four games, he only was able to make four draws, and still sitting at the bottom of the table, all that together with four more grandmasters. All that with 2 points. Of course, there is still time for any of them to improve their tournament situation, but making up the 2-point differential in only remaining 4 games appears to be unlikely. In the meantime, let me show you another win by Vidiot, which happened yesterday. And this time he was able to defeat a very hot player, Alireza Firouzi. Firouzi got a late invitation to the tournament because one of the Chinese participants who was slated to play, I believe that was Wei Yi, unfortunately wasn't able to come because of an ongoing stuff in China. So Firouzi entered the tournament and he did quite well at the start. He won one game and he was looking at this game to overtake Vidiot for the tournament lead. And it went into the slough, and now a very practical decision. Once again, I bring this to your attention, that when you're in a leading position in the tournament and others are playing catch-up, particularly young players, you know, upstart, hot hand, whatever, you know, then you can slow things down and put them in a situation where, if they are willing to take any risks, that would be perhaps inappropriate. It's a good decision by Santosh. So this is one of the standard lines. Obviously, in this move order, black didn't want to play knight g4, bishop to g4, because it wasn't pinned yet after rook c1. Right, white could play knight e5. So it goes almost symmetrical. And indeed, black can just go on with bishop e7, and no, it's not entirely clear if rook c1 is so much more useful than a6, or the white then would continue with the similar plan, knight a4, knight c5. But, as somewhat expected, Ferrugia went for a very sharp move, queen b6. And he accepted the pawn. Now, this had already happened before in the game between Georg Meyer and Mikhail Gurevich, which saw knight h4, bishop e4, f3, and white was able to get that bishop and regain the pawn. Although the consequences turned out to be unclear because of a very strong move g5. It turned out that the white rook on c7, however active it is quite vulnerable to this bishop d6 business, attacking h2 and so on. It was a very unpleasant move to receive g5, and then led to a complex situation where black was able to win. So perhaps Ferrugia counted on that line when he went for the b2 pawn. However, he was surprised by yet another novelty, a3. All right, it seems like black could take this pawn, but that would cost him the exchange, right? In itself, it doesn't seem so catastrophic, or two pawns, but no, black still needs to complete their development, and if they do it this way, they don't have time to play knight e4, unfortunately, because of bishop takes a6. So some other move is needed, maybe knight a5, but then white establishes his knight in the center. I believe that white is better here. Black still cannot consolidate and prepare for his counterplay with the bishop pair and the two connected passed pawns. We have more of a middle game situation, and I think white stands quite well. But queen a5, the alternative chosen by the young Ali Reza, was even worse, because he simply didn't have any possible defense to that pawn on b7. No, clearly, rook a7, the last resort, falls to rook takes c6, followed by queen b8 check. So, like it or not, he had to play b5, and then, catastrophic delay in development created this situation where black simply had no way out, no way to defend against rook c8 check. Well, the measures taken by Ferrugia, they're understandable. He was trying to confuse matters, but he wasn't really able to do this. If he takes the pawn on a3 in this situation, then white wins by giving these checks with the queen and eventually getting to f7. So he had to play b4 and then knight e4. So the c8 square, of course, is covered. That was the purpose of the e-pawn sacrifice. But white now enjoys a long-term advantage. They're actually up a pawn, and they're hitting a6. No way out, I'm afraid. Knight there. A bigger problem. The bishop on b4 cannot stay on the diagonal, protecting the e7 square. Ferrugia tried his last trick, hoping to make use of white's backrank problem, but a very resolute reply from Santosh Vidyat simply finished the game, because now two pieces are under attack and there's nothing to be done. Another crushing victory right out of the opening. Well, sandwich between these two victories was also Vidyat's very nice win on the white side of the Grünfeld against Markus Rager. So what can I say? The tournament has a clear leader, and we'll see what the conclusion of the tournament will bring. Thank you very much for your attention. This was Grandmaster Aleš Shermolinsky reporting from Prague Masters. Goodbye.